opportunities as the in the electronic division of SNECMA. He found opportunities in the procurement organization in 2003. He took successive positions in Hispano Souza and SNECMA dealing with different commodities before relocating to Safran headquarters. As a Safran executive, Terry is vice president for Safran Materials Purchases since 2015. Please help me welcome Terry Figure.
Good morning, and thank you for coming. We are a few people this morning. This is the end of the ITA, and maybe some of you start to be a little bit tired with the long gambling on the evening. I don't know. So, I am Thierry Viguier, Safran Vice President in charge of materials procurement for the Safran Group. But before, maybe I have to... Yes. Before starting the presentation and introduction of Safran, I would like to share with you a relevant fact about aeronautics, about French aeronautics. 128 years after Clément Ader's first flight, France remained at the forefront of world aeronautics. According to a US study conducted by Thiel Group, an aerodynamic analyst, the French aeronautics and space industry ranks second in the world, behind the US and ahead of China, with a sale of $69 billion in 2017. France is, along with the United States, the only exporting country of commercial aircraft, business jets, helicopters and fighters, and the main contributor of European space industry. And Safran is the main French players, as we can see on the following chart. So just a quick word about Safran and its main activity in 2018. The main fact you are probably aware of is the acquisition of Zodiac by Safran. This acquisition reinforces its core business of aerospace equipment and defense. But this acquisition put also Safran and its 21 billion euros of revenue as the third aerospace company worldwide, excluding aircraft manufacturer. Safran is proud also to be world number two aircraft equipment manufacturer. Having said that, let us go now through the subject of the day, titanium role in modern aircraft engines. So, among the Safran portfolio, aircraft engines are one of the key equipment designed and manufactured by Safran since the early last century. This morning, we will have a look at the role of Safran in today's single-aisle aircraft market and in the future, including new mid-size aircraft. We will see also what is the titanium role in an engine and what could be its future, taking into account weaknesses and opportunities. But in first, let's see how the foundation of the future is made on a strong and robust history. Starting by the beginning, commercial engine business started at Safran more than 50 years ago when two great men, René Raveau and Gerhard Neumann, shared the same vision. In the early 70s, the newborn GE Safran partnership brought benefit of high bypass turbofan technology to reduce fuel burn by 20% compared to the low bypass engine they replaced. They also introduced a new standard in reliability. These two visionary men created an incredible successful engine family by joining their forces and knowledge in a 50-50 joint venture. CFM and the CFM56 were born. As you probably know, CF stands for commercial fan, the G appellation of its engines. Maybe you don't know that M56 stands for Motor 56, meaning it was the 56th engine project launched by Safran, SNECMA this time. So some figures to quantify this success: 33,000 engines delivered already to more than 570 customers worldwide. Every 2 seconds, a CFM aircraft, a powered aircraft, take off, and we have accumulated 900 plus million engine flight hours with a dispatch reliability very close to 100%, which take benefits to the more than 3 million passengers daily. When I did this presentation, I was surprised myself with this number. So, we are defining history. Today, we are very proud to continue this adventure, and we must keep the excellence at the level of the engagement of René Ravo and Gerhard Neumann. We must continue to define history, and we do. Actually, Safran and GE renew the CFM partnership until 2040, and in 2016, CFM introduced a new standard in high-bypass turbofan with the LEAP family. And the success is there. 63 operators, there will be 80 operators by 2020, made their trust into the LEAP on 430 aircraft already. After 2 years, we achieved more than 2 million engine flight hours with an utilization rate better than 96%, which is well above the concurrence. As of today, more than 1,000 LEAP engines have been shipped, and we plan to deliver more than 1,100 engines this year, much more than 1,100. 2 years after the entry into service of the LEAP, Safran has already 16,000 engines in order, corresponding to about 7 years of production. What you have to figure out is that means that during the next 7 years, we will produce 50% of what has been done previously in about 40 years. That means also that we will produce and deliver to our customer more than 6 engines a day. 6 engines a day. In this context, every day, every part matters. So, what is the potential market for the LEAP over the next 20 years, taking into account an economic growth of about 2.8%, we saw that already on the Boeing and Airbus presentation, a revenue passenger kilometers growth of 4.5% average during the next 20 years, leading to a global fleet growth almost multiplied by 2. Meaning that Safran figure out that 39,000 new aircraft will be delivered during this 20 years period of time. I heard during the ITA that some of the presenters talk about 40,000, 42,000, 43,000. We are on a low level of the forecast at 39,000. But these 39,000 aircraft, among them, there is 60% which are short, medium range jets, which is the business of Safran. And this corresponding 24,000 short medium aircraft represent roughly 50,000 engines. So for Safran, if CFM maintains its market share, this could represent much more than twice the 16,000 engines already in order. To be more clear, we can forecast 37,000 engines on the 20 years. And we believe at Safran that this forecast is still conservative. Typical production downturn has not occurred in over 10 years. Even the financial crisis of 2008 has had finally a limited impact on the aircraft production cycle. Projection of energy price remain, I will say, reasonable. And the aerospace industry is facing a growing demand of the revenue passenger kilometers. In fact, if a revenue passenger kilometer grows of more than 6%, and this growth is expected until 2020, macro dynamics may drive slight adjustment, but we have to consider that the backlog is very robust. So if I have to make a link between this revenue passenger kilometer growth and the rate that Airbus and Boeing give to the supply chain. From our analysis, I will say that a 6% growth of the revenue passenger kilometer represents an average Airbus-Boeing production rate per month of 63 aircraft. 8% growth would represent a production rate of 75 aircraft. However, we should not forget the CFM56 engine. While the LEAP engine ramp up continuously, the CFM56 continue to set the benchmark on delivery. And even if deliveries ramp down, shop visits will continue to grow until 2020 plus and will drive a huge materials demand. In fact, you have to consider that as of today, 60% of the 21,000 in-service engine did not have yet their first shop visit. This means that the next 20 years will drive a lot of material and titanium demands. So this point closes the chapter on engine forecast for the single-aisle aircraft market. I propose now to have a look on some technical aspects of the LEAP engine. And again, go back a little bit in the past, 10 years ago. 10 years ago, we made a promise to the market. And I even should say we made several promises to the market. We said that our engine for single-aisle aircraft will have 15%, will save, 15% of fuel burn. Like the CFM56, its predecessor, which have already, I remember, 20% of fuel burn, the LEAP brings the benefit of high bypass turbofan, new technologies, and new materials. We said also that the LEAP will reduce by 50% the NOx and reach the noise regulation while it will keep its position of best in class for reliability and maintenance cost. This is what we said to the market 10 years ago. Today, we are very proud at Safran for this accomplishment. Only 2 years after entry into service of the LEAP engine and after its first 2 million plus engine flight hours, we can say that we offer to the market 15% fuel efficiency, both NOx and noise target achievements, already 96% plus utilization. I even heard just before coming here that the figures could be at 98% already, but I cannot guarantee this level. Even if we are clearly aware that it is not enough for our customer, this value puts the LEAP well above the competition. And as an evidence of the tremendous success, 60 plus operators put already their trust on LEAP and ordered 16,000 plus engines. So, how did we accomplish such a success story? First, we took advantage of the lesson learned from the 900 million of engine flight hours realized by the CFM56 engine family. We also brought a bench of new technology, new design techniques, and new materials. We hardly worked on thermodynamic design. We increased again the bypass and compression ratio. We used 3D aerodynamic design, particularly on low pressure turbine. And we develop and use as much as possible lightweight materials. Keep in mind that the material used to make engine parts play a significant role in environmental performance. Choosing the right one is very important because lighter parts help reduce fuel consumption and emissions. And the resistance, this is a key point, to high temperature means we can improve the thermal efficiency of the turbo machine. So as you know, we introduce resin transfer molding and 3D woven carbon fiber technology to produce the fan blades and the fan case. This helped to save 500 pounds compared to old technology. On the Safran share of the LEAP engine, The titanium part of the engine grew by 30% if we compare a LEAP-1B and the CFM56-7. Main parts made from titanium are the fan disc and the fan blade leading edge, the fan hub frame, as well as the fan frame shroud strut and shroud link, which were not in titanium in the CFM56 engine. The booster, the vane and the blades of the low pressure turbine, some bearing housing, support, and the kit engine package, including tube, struts, and many others. To produce all these parts, Safran and its supply chain use different types of grade. 6-4 is the main titanium used in different levels of quality, from standard to premium and disc quality. But we develop also with our partner a titanium aluminide alloys to be used in an environment of the blade of the low pressure turbine. We also use different types of production routes, casting for fan hub frame, the low pressure turbine blade, and numerous small and medium sized parts. Conversion route or extrusion for static and rotating parts, like fan frame shroud, leaning edge, fan disc, booster spool, bearing housings, and others. So, the development job seems to be done and seems to be well done. Now we have to produce at an intensive and growing rate. The guy from the production floor are in charge and all the supply chain. All the supply chain must be behind them to reach the ambitious target given by our customers. You heard like me, Airbus and Boeing asking for material. Keep in mind that every day, every part matters to achieve our daily commitment. However, the marketing and design office of our customer are already thinking about the next future, and so do we. Airbus and Boeing could propose in the next decade a new mid-size aircraft to replace the old 757 or 767, but also to open new routes. They have conversation with their customers, airlines and lessors, to outline the design of the future new mid-size aircraft. With 45 to 50,000 pounds of thrust, CFM offers an engine for the NMA with the same work sharing as CFM56 and LEAP engine. All activities will be shared 50-50, sales, design, development, production and support and service, with the same work share than for the CFM56 and LEAP engine. At Safran and GE are working together on new concepts for the NMA, but also for future applications. Development are still on the bypass ratio, which is key for the efficiency of the engine. This is demonstrated by the ducted ultra-high bypass ratio engine, or by the unducted open rotor, which offer a new technology to increase again the bypass ratio and which use two stages of fan blade with two directions of rotation. You have to notice that this open rotor technology or unducted fan was already under studies 30 years ago. GE and Safran and NASA were associated to find a very efficient propulsion system following the energy price recession of the late 70s. The name of the project was the GE36, and it has been finally cancelled in 1989 following the energy price relaxation. But the concept was born. The studies are even on a longer term than open rotor. They are on new architecture, but also on new integration in the aircraft, and even on new propulsive architecture. To illustrate this purpose, as an example, maybe some of you heard about the launch by Zunum Aero of its ZA-10, a regional jet with an hybrid propulsion system. This jet will transport 12 passengers on distance up to 700 miles for a cost 60 to 80% below a classical regional jet. Zunum is supported by Boeing and JetBlue Airways in this project. Safran helicopter engine will supply the engine, which will drive a generator to charge the batteries able to supply the energy to two electrical engines of 500 kilowatts each. The future is already there. However, this technology seems to be limited to small aeronefs. Actually, even in the hypothesis of a multiplication by five of the power of the best battery of today, we will need 180 tons of batteries to make an 80-ton A320 Airbus flying. So there is some improvement to be made. So, in this context, what is the future of titanium in this very innovative industry? More than ever, we need to save weight to reduce consumption of energy from oil or electricity. More than ever, we need lighter, high-temperature material to improve thermal efficiency of the engines. More than ever, we need innovation from our supply chain, including from the materials elaborators. Composite materials are now well installed in the fan environment, like it is on the G90, the G9X, and on the LEAP engine for the fan blades and fan case. This helps saving weight and improves the bypass ratio by authorizing a bigger fan. This industry is very innovative and invests a lot on new technologies like high temperatures resin, but also thermoplastic with higher temperature. The aluminium is much more cheaper than titanium and is used when there is no too much constraints or when composite is not competitive. So I see two ways of development for the titanium-based alloy. One is to increase its temperature of operation to be able to use it in an environment reserved today to superalloy, like rotating parts. The second one is to have additive manufacturing able to be used to produce large and complex parts at an economic price. I would like to spend some time on this subject. Safran was one of the pioneers of the additive manufacturing. The first work started in 2008 at Safran Aircraft Engine. Other companies in the group have also explored the potential of this technology. To support their efforts, in 2015, we created a centralized structure called Safran Additive Manufacturing, attached to our Safran Tech Research Center. After several experimental applications, the question of the transition to mass production has arisen. This is where several difficulties appear. One of the main ones remains the dimension of the part, constrained by the existing machine on the market. The other is the cost, because additive manufacturing is more expensive than conventional production processes. Its productivity is still insufficient to compete with these same processes. So, rather than limiting additive manufacturing to production, we then focused our efforts on a more differentiating and value-adding logic, I mean design. I'm not talking here about changing the design of a part, but to manufacture in one piece component previously made for several parts assembled together. A good illustration is a fuel injector, a particularly complex piece that can be produced cheaply through additive manufacturing. On Arano from Safran Helicopter Engine, fuel injectors are made by laser melting on a metal powder bed, a manufacturing process also used for other parts of the Ardiden 3 engine combustion chamber. Aware of this potential, Our customers are encouraging us to integrate more and more additive manufacturing into our parts. Two examples. In 2017, a co-innovation partnership was signed by an aircraft manufacturer and Safran Landing System to develop a titanium hydraulic unit. Since 2018, Safran Aircraft Engine has mass-produced a part located on the low-pressure part of the CFM56-7B engine. With its low production rate and its highly technical product, where the mass issue is important, the aerospace sector is the most suitable sector for the use of additive manufacturing. Today, at Safran, the technology is ready for mass production. We have identified target products, and our customers are very demanding. It is a strategic axis of the group. We will ramp up production volume of metal parts, while the integration of Zodiac Aerospace will accelerate us in the field of polymer additive manufacturing. Additive manufacturing over the long term will, for sure, profoundly change the design of our product and open up possibilities that we could not have imagined just a few years ago. On the industrial and human level, it will be a great playground. But, for instance, let's go back to conventional processes. Safran is expecting its supply chain to propose titanium-based alloys that could replace current 6242 or 21S, currently used on exhaust, for example. Safran is looking also for a titanium-based alloy to be used for rotating parts, like a high-temperature disc. The weight saving could be very significant if we had such alloys for the high-pressure compressor. So we are looking for weight saving and cost saving on every equipment we supply to our customers. But, as an example for the landing gears, we are using specific high-strength titanium for their characteristic and compromise between mechanical properties and density. However, because of the market price of such titanium, Safran Landing System is obliged to switch back to more classical 6-4 or even steel, even if the weight increases. And I noted that Jeff Carpenter from Boeing has had the same comment on Monday. Same thing with the titanium powder. There is a huge of opportunities for complex parts to be done with additive manufacturing. But to do so, the market needs a price well below the 3 digits per kilogram. So, bringing back home as a wrap-up, things I would like you keep in mind. Aerospace is still a growing market. 6% plus revenue passenger kilometer growth. And Safran has a major share on this story with its 75% market share on single L aircraft. We have been working on the buy-to-fly ratio, but for the next decade, every day, Safran will continue to use 20 metric tons of titanium, not taking into account the 20,000 plus engine in service and the associated maintenance activities. Titanium-based alloys have a great future in this industry. Lighter parts help reduce fuel consumption and emissions, and the resistance to high temperature means the thermal efficiency of turbo machine can be improved. Titanium powder could be extensively used by additive manufacturing new technology if they reach the market price. So Safran reputation is engaged in the most successful engine program ever. Safran gave its trust to the supply chain by offering 75% of the production of the engine to its partners. Keep well in mind that to satisfy our customers, every day, every part matters. Thank you very much for your attention.